Hebrews chapter 11, beginning in verse 1, and the word of God reads, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear." Now go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Just a few verses over. Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in verse 1. "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." Verse 2, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him, Jesus, that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin." Verse 5, "And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks unto you as children. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him." And I want to minister a message this morning. It may not be a shouting message. If we truly understand what the apostle here is telling us and proclaiming to us in these passages of Scripture, it will be a shouting message. But when the Lord first brought it to me and the Lord first pricked my heart with this message, it wasn't on shouting ground.
Come on.
Because the Lord had to show me some things about myself that needed to be addressed. The Lord had to do some things in me that He had to do that were not right, that were not lining up with the Word of God. He had to show me some things about me.
Amen.
And it's not easy when the Lord begins to show you things about yourself.
Amen.
Because whether you realize it or not, yourself, you in and of yourself without God, is not a pretty picture.
That's right.
So I want to minister a message this morning entitled "Faith, the Promise and the Process." Or we can entitle it "Faith for the Promise and Faith for the Process."
Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, and we do so in the name of your Son, Jesus, Lord. Father, I do thank you for this opportunity that you've given me to minister your word. Lord, even now I sense the presence of your Spirit in this place, O God. Father, from the time we began praise and worship, Lord God, through the prayer, Lord, even to now, Lord, I can just sense your presence in this place, O God. And where your presence is, Lord God, we know that you desire to do something, Lord.
Yes.
You desire to touch our hearts. You desire to speak to us, Lord. And I would but ask you this morning, O God, that you would move me out of the way, O God. Lord, that your Spirit would have free course in this place, O God, that you would anoint my mind, that you would anoint my heart to do nothing but to speak your word, Lord, in clarity and in truth, O God. Anoint every one of our hearts, Lord, to receive that which you have for us this morning. And Lord, we'll be sure when it's all said and done, as we do now, to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said,
amen.
And amen. The book of Hebrews was written, many scholars are divided in their opinion as to who wrote the book of Hebrews. I personally believe, through my very little amount of study that I've done of the book, I believe it was the Apostle Paul. Some scholars don't believe that because the Greek text is different from the way he writes in other books. But the way I look at it is, I don't see another man in the Word of God, or I should say in the New Testament, who understood both the law and the redemption plan of God as this individual did in the book of Hebrews, the author of the book of Hebrews. The way he lays out the old Levitical system, and the way that he lays out the old system of law and routine and regulation, and then brings us in to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, brings us in to the plan, the redemption plan of Almighty God. The way he makes that connection, I don't see this author being anyone else but the Apostle Paul himself. And in the book of Hebrews, the book of Hebrews begins the first several chapters by warning believers. This we've got to understand that this book is not written to unbelievers. I don't believe. This book is written to believers who at this time were being persecuted for their new found faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. These were people who at one time were under the Judeo system of law. They were under the Levitical system of law. They believed the Old Testament sacrifice. They placed their faith in Judaism. They placed their faith in the law. But now they've, by faith, accepted the Messiah. They've accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And now they're beginning to make the transition from works and law to faith. Amen. They're trying to make a transition from law and works to grace and faith, like Matt talked about a moment ago. Every one of us have to experience that transition. Because every one of us, from the time that we're born into this world, there's a mindset on the inside of us that says, I have to do something in order to be right. Every single one of us are born with that exact mentality. When you raise children, you show them what to do. You show them, don't do this, don't do that. You can't go here, you can't go there. That's just how we're raised. That's our mentality. That's the human mind. Amen. But the mind of God is not the mind of man.
Amen.
There is a moral law that we must submit ourselves to. There is a moral standard that we must look to and that we must follow.
Yes.
But that is not how we are made right with God.
Amen.
That is not how we are brought into right fellowship and right relationship with God. It's not through the keeping of ordinances or the keeping of law, or I do this so much or I do that so much. That's not how I am made right with God. I am made right through God because His Son has come to this earth and has given me access through the blood that He shed at Calvary's cross. And that's what Paul talks about in the book of Hebrews. That you don't have to try to approach God by law, because if you do that, you're going to be rejected.
Yes.
If you try to come to God by the means of law, by the means of your own righteousness, by the means of your own understanding, then you're going to be rejected every single time.
Amen.
The only way that you can come to God, Paul exclaims, is through the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why he would say that we have access.
Amen.
Over and over again in the book of Hebrews, Paul would talk about how that the Lord Jesus Christ, that he was not just a sacrifice of the Old Testament. A sacrifice in the Old Testament had to be a sacrifice that was performed every day. Something had to go on. But Paul says that this man, after he sacrificed himself one time, sat down at the right hand of God to sanctify those who believe in him forever and forever. So what does that tell you and I? That the work that Jesus accomplished at Calvary was a finished work. Not just was a finished work, but is presently now and ever shall be a finished work. When he said it is finished, what Jesus was saying when he said it is finished on Calvary's cross, when he gave up the ghost and he gave up his body to heaven, when he gave up his life on Calvary's cross, what he meant was that the law, everything that the law required of man, has now been fulfilled.
Amen.
And now if man is to come to God, the only way he can come is through faith and grace. The only way that he can come is through faith in what I've accomplished for him at this present moment and in this present time.
Hallelujah.
And the work that he accomplished when he said it is finished, he said it's finished for the past, it's finished for the present, and it's finished for future.
Hallelujah.
It's finished for the past, it's finished for the present, and it's finished for the future.
Amen.
So that God could look at man and say, I forgive you of your sins of the past, I forgive you of your present unrighteous condition, and I'm going to forgive you a week from now or 10 years from now when you call upon my name and you place your faith in my redemption plan. That's the plan of God.
Hallelujah.
The plan of God was that it would be finished. This was the plan of God from before the foundation of the world, that Jesus Christ would come and bring man to God, because man could not reach God in and of his own standard, in and of his own righteousness. So Jesus had to come down and bring man to God and bring God to man.
Hallelujah.
That's what Jesus had to do. And in the book of Hebrews, this is what Paul is talking about. He's warning the believers, flee from unbelief.
Yes.
Flee from those things that tell you you need to place yourself back under the bondage of law. Flee from the people that are telling you you need to go back to the old law, the old routine. Because what you have now is so much better than what you had under the law.
Amen.
What you have now, Jesus Christ, is so much more superior than that which you had under the law. So this is what he's trying to tell the believers in the book of Hebrews. And when he gets to Hebrews chapter 11, we've read the two passages, Hebrews chapter 11 and Hebrews chapter 12. In Hebrews chapter 11, Paul begins to lay out what it means for a person to live by faith. And he would give us the example in Hebrews chapter 11. You can read example after example after example after example. I didn't even count how many there were, but there are untold examples just in this chapter alone of the results of someone's life who has placed their faith in God and His redemption plan.
Amen.
Because under the Old Testament, they did not know what we know now. But they had a minute knowledge of what was to come, because Jesus told the Pharisees and Sadducees that Abraham saw my day and he rejoiced and was exceeding glad. So they didn't know all of what we now know or all of what we now should know.
Amen.
But they had a minuscule understanding of what was to come, the price that the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, would have to pay at Calvary's cross. So in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, Paul begins to lay out the results of someone's life who has placed their faith in Christ and what he's done at the cross. And the first one he starts with is Abraham. He talks about how that Abraham was a man of faith, how that God revealed himself to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. Abraham did not know anything about God, did not know who God was. His parents were not godly. He did not know anything about God. His family, he came from a family of idol makers. But yet God showed up to him in the midst of that debauchery, in the midst of that sin, in the midst of that wickedness, and said, Abraham, if you will follow me, I will make you a father of many nations.
Amen.
So the moment he called Abraham, he gave Abraham a promise.
Yes.
The moment that he saved Abraham, the moment that Abraham, by faith, placed his trust in the Lord Jehovah, he didn't understand it all. You see, God's not asking us to understand everything. He wants us to believe Him.
Amen.
We believe first, and then He brings understanding. It's not for you to understand and then believe, because if that were the case, you'll never understand.
Amen.
Because our finite minds cannot understand the plan of God. We cannot understand what God requires of us. We cannot understand what God is asking us to do. So our job, first and foremost, is to believe. To believe God, to place our faith in God and what He has revealed to us. And what He has revealed to us is His redemption plan. What He revealed to Abraham in some way, shape, form, or fashion was an aspect of His redemption plan. And Abraham said, because of this, I'm going to follow you. And the Lord gave Abraham a promise. He said, I'm going to make you a father of many nations. Through your seed will the seed of the Messiah come. Through your seed, Abraham, will the Savior, the Redeemer of all mankind, through your seed will He come. Whenever you and I are born again, I don't know about you, but when I was born again, God began to work in my heart. God began, when I was truly born again.
Yes.
Come on.
Amen.
Not when I was caught up in religion.
Yes.
Not when I was just going to church and living how I wanted to live outside the doors and just doing my own thing. No, when I was truly born again. And filled with the Spirit of Almighty God. I don't know about you, but God began to do some things in my heart and in my life. He began to show me, number one, who I was and who He was. He began to promise me things, not only from His Word, but from my personal life. He began to show me the plan that He had for me. I don't understand it. I still don't understand it to this day. But He began to reveal to me the plans that He had for me in the time in which I would live. He began to show me things. He began to promise me things. And Abraham experienced this very same thing. But the Lord also told Abraham, He said, I will make you a father of many nations. But He also told him, Abraham, I am your shield and your exceeding great reward.
Yes.
So don't get your eyes so focused on the promise that you forget that I am the reward for which you work. I am the reward for which you believe. I am the reward for which you seek. He's the reward. Even though Abraham had these might, perhaps the mightiest promise that has been promised to anyone throughout Scripture, that he would be the father of the people of faith. Paul said that Abraham was not the father of law, Because the law was not given whenever Abraham was living. He wasn't the father of the Levitical system or of the law. He was the father of those who would place their faith in God and his redemption plan. We're heirs of Abraham, not because of what we do and what we don't do, but we're heirs of Abraham because of what we believe.
Amen.
And that's what Jesus told the Pharisees in John chapter 8. He said, you think that you're the sons and the daughters of Abraham because of what you do, and I'm paraphrasing, because of what you do and what you don't do. But you don't understand that your father is the devil. Because they thought that they were earning some type of righteousness from God. They thought that what they did and what they didn't do earned them from God what only faith and grace could bring to them.
Amen.
So he told them, he gave them the verdict that you are of your father, the devil. And if you knew truly who Abraham was and what Abraham believed, then you would do the works of Abraham. Now, what's the works of Abraham? Faith and obedience.
Yes. Amen.
That's the work of Abraham. Faith and obedience. Good. Obedience comes after faith, because you cannot be obedient to God unless your faith is properly placed in the power source that he has provided for you. It cannot happen. You cannot be obedient to God. You can't keep the law. You can't keep the Ten Commandments. You can't do all these things that in your mind you think you need to do in order to please God. You cannot do it in and of your own power.
That's right.
There's too much of the fallen man left in you.
Amen.
There's too much of the fallen nature still within you in order for you to operate outside of God's redemption plan, thinking that you can do something in order to please him. What pleases God is faith.
Amen.
Faith is what pleases God. And Paul would even say that in Hebrews 11 and verse 6. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him.
Amen.
So the only thing that pleases God is faith.
Yeah.
But faith doesn't stand alone, because faith, it can be a very general term.
Right.
Because almost all of the modern church today says that you've got to live by faith. The modern Christian church tells you, you've got to live by faith. You've got to do this by faith. But what kind of faith are you talking about?
Right. Amen.
Because I can't stand, and this is a pet peeve of mine, and so you'll have to forgive me, but I can't stand when I see sinners, I mean outright sinners, just making the statement, well, you just got to have faith. And not even sinners, I'm talking about just people, and I'm talking about as well people in the church. Well, you just got to have faith. But faith in what? That's the problem. That's the issue. What is our faith in? Who is our faith in?
Right.
Our faith must be singularly placed in Jesus Christ and what he's done for us at Calvary's cross. Well, what if I need a blessing from God? Then that's where my faith needs to be.
Yeah.
What if I need a financial blessing? Then that's where my faith needs to be.
Amen.
What if I need healing? What if I need deliverance? What if I'm struggling with sin? Then your faith needs to be in Jesus Christ and what he's accomplished for you at Calvary's cross. Because it was at Calvary's cross that he broke the power of sin.
Amen.
It was at Calvary's cross that he ridded you of your sin problem, and he opened up the avenue by which you can receive the blessings from God that you so need and desire.
Amen.
It's faith. It is the faith of the Son of God. So Paul here in Hebrews 11 would begin to lay out the fact that everything that we receive from God, all these great men of God, he would talk about Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham and Sarah, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, all of these great men and women of God that we see in the Old Testament, how did they receive from God what they received? They received it by faith. God promised them something, and maybe they didn't see the full fulfillment of that promise in their life. But whatever they received from God came by faith.
Amen.
So everything that you and I receive from God, that we receive from God, we receive it because of faith.
Amen.
Everything that you and I receive. Don't think that there's anything that you can earn from God outside of the parameters of your faith being placed in Christ and what he's done at the cross.
Amen.
It's faith. Faith in Christ and who he is, and faith in what he's done.
Amen.
Faith in who he is and faith in what he's done. It's not just faith in who he is. Because he could have come to this earth, he could have been the Son of God, but had he not given himself a sacrifice on Calvary's cross, the avenue could not have been open for you and I to receive from God that which we so desperately needed.
Amen.
So it's who God is, it's who Jesus is, and it's what Jesus has accomplished for us at Calvary's cross. And Paul would say that in 1 Corinthians 1:18, that the preaching of the cross, it's foolishness to them who are perishing, but unto us who are saved, it is the power of God.
Yes. Amen.
And the promises that these Old Testament saints were believing for, more than anything, was the coming of the Messiah.
Yes.
Was the fulfillment of God's redemption plan more than anything else.
That's right.
They believed God for these natural promises, but don't forget what God told Abraham. When God called Abraham, he said, Abraham, if you'll follow me, yes, I'll make you a father of many nations. But don't forget, I'm the one who is your shield, and I am the one who is your exceeding great reward.
Yes.
I'm going to give you all these blessings and all these mighty promises, but more than all of that, I am going to be your God, and your people are going to be my people. That was the promise of God. That was the promise that Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses and Noah and all these great men of God, that's the promise that they were awaiting. You would remember David in 2 Samuel chapter 6 and 7, how that God would begin to move upon David's heart and he would begin to show him his plan for the future. And he would tell David that, David, there's coming a day. You're desiring to build my kingdom. You're desiring to work for me. But there's coming a day when my kingdom, my eternal kingdom, is going to be established through your loins. That through your seed will come the fulfillment of what I've been prophesying about for some 3,500 years now. Through your seed is going to come that promise. So all the Old Testament promises, all the Old Testament prophets, that's what they were awaiting. Was the fulfillment of God's promise, which ultimately his promise was that a Redeemer would come into the world and would make things right between man and God once again.
Amen.
That was the promise of God, and that God's Spirit would then be able to dwell within the hearts and lives of his people all throughout the world. That the law, that we would no longer have to follow the law from a means of a physical sense, looking at the law and trying to follow it, but that the law of God would now be imprinted and implanted upon the hearts of those who would receive the Son of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
So Paul begins to show us all these Old Testament prophets. Look at what they accomplished by faith. He begins to tell us, look at these things. Look at the mighty promises and the mighty blessings that God poured out upon them by faith. How that the Red Sea was open. How that they crossed over Jordan. How that David took a stone and slew Goliath. And he doesn't mention all this, but these are as well aspects of what he's talking about. All of these were accomplished because these people chose to place their faith in Christ, who he was, and what he was going to do, even though they didn't have a full understanding of it. So Paul goes on into Hebrews chapter 12, and he begins to make a difference between... Now, in Hebrews 11 and Hebrews 12, I want to say this. Two separate passages, two separate circumstances. In Hebrews chapter 11, Paul's talking about the Old Testament saints. He's talking about the Old Testament prophets. Hebrews chapter 12, Paul is now addressing us as believers. And really, in both passages, they can be applicable to us today. But we have two separate passages, two separate events, two separate circumstances that Paul's talking about, but yet he's talking about the same faith.
Amen.
This is what we've got to understand. It's not a different faith. The faith that you and I have is not a different faith than what they had under the Old Testament.
Right, right,
it's not a different faith, but it is a more narrow and a purified faith.
Yes, good.
Because they didn't have the knowledge that you and I have today. But the knowledge that we have, the message of the cross has been revealed to us. The message of Jesus Christ and him crucified. Christ has now come. He has now given his life on Calvary's cross. So now the faith that we have, it's more minute. It's more focused where, as it ought to be. And most of the modern church, I know we proclaim faith for many things, like I said a minute ago. We proclaim faith for blessings. We proclaim faith for prosperity. We proclaim faith for this. You got to have faith if you want to be a good person, if you want to achieve success. And, you know, all these modern teachers and preachers telling us how to be successful in the church and how to be successful financially. And that's all good and that's all great. But more than all of that, more than the promises and the blessings, God wants to get you to the place where you begin to learn who He is.
Yes.
More than just blessing you and pouring out His promises upon you. That is simply a result of the relationship that you have with your Heavenly Father. If the only type of faith that you exclaim and that you experience is faith for promises, faith for blessings, faith for prosperity, if that's the only type of faith that you are experiencing presently as a Christian, then the faith that you have is no faith at all.
Come on.
Because faith requires something of you.
That's good
stuff. Faith requires something of you. And that requirement from you, if you're going to be a person who lives by faith, who proclaims faith, who says, I'm a faith man or I'm a faith woman, it's going to require you to lay down yourself at the feet of Jesus and allow Him to do in you and through you what only He can do.
Come on.
Faith requires something of you. Yeah. And what it requires is you.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
What faith requires is you, and I'm going to explain myself in a moment. But faith, I want you to get that, because that's good. I didn't think about that. Faith requires you.
Amen.
That's what faith requires. Faith is going to cost you something. If you're going to live by faith in the present time and in the present hour in which we live, it's going to cost you something. And what it's going to cost you is your life.
Amen.
I don't mean every time it's going to cost you your physical life, even though very soon it may cost you exactly
Amen.
That. The way that our world and the way that our country is going, God help us.
Amen.
It may cost you your physical life. But more than that, more important to God, that means nothing to God. Your physical life doesn't mean anything to God. He wants your heart.
That's
what God, more than your physical body, more than your mouth, more than your hands, God wants your heart. Because you can be doing all the right things outwardly, but yet your heart not be where God wants it to be. You can be doing all the right things. You can be preaching all the great messages. You can be preaching in different countries. You can be going here, there, and everywhere, doing all these great things for God. But if God does not have your heart, then He is not satisfied with you.
Amen.
I know that's strong, but this is what God had to show me.
Yeah.
And that's the only reason I'm preaching this message this morning, is because God is not interested. If you're more interested in what you do for God rather than your relationship with God, then you've got to get some things right.
Come on.
Some things have to be made right and have to be aligned correctly in your heart and in your life. You can prophesy, you can sing, you can do all these things, you can even be used by the Spirit of God. But if He doesn't have your heart, then He is not satisfied.
Come on.
That's right.
And in order for God to have your heart, it's going to require you to lay yourself down at the foot of the cross and say, God, there's nothing that I can do in and of myself.
Right.
You've got to be brought to a place that you admit that, Lord, I am nothing. I am wretched. I am wicked. And Lord, without You in Your presence, I can accomplish nothing for Your glory and for Your honor. The greatest thing that God is trying to do in His present, in this present hour, in His present church, He wants you to address you.
Yeah.
Good.
That's the issue.
That's good.
Your neighbor is not the issue.
Come on.
The pastor is not the issue. The layman, the singer, the worship leader, they're not the issue. Get your eyes off of everyone else. And realize that there is a change that needs to take place on the inside of you.
Come on.
You're not where you need to be.
Yeah, that's
and right. I'm not speaking this message in condemnation, because there's an answer. But you're not where you need to be.
Come on.
You're not yet where God wants you to be.
Amen.
And to be honest with you, you never will be until the trump of God sounds.
Hallelujah.
So what am I trying to say this morning? What I'm trying to tell you is that there's some things in you that God's going to have to address, that God's going to have to do in and through you, in your heart and in your life, that you're not going to like.
Come on.
Because the same faith that God gave the old prophets, the old saints of the Old Testament, the same faith He gave them to believe God for the promises is the same faith He's given you and I to believe Him for the process.
Amen.
What process are you talking about? I'm talking about sanctification. I'm talking about being made into the image of God. True faith not only believes God for miracles and mighty blessings and outpourings, and that's great because I believe God for an outpouring of His Spirit. I believe that before the rapture takes place, that this world is going to experience the greatest move of God that we've ever seen before. I believe that sick bodies are going to be healed. I believe that blinded eyes are going to be opened. I believe that the physical dead are going to be raised before our very eyes. I believe that. I declare that. I prophesy that in the name of Jesus, that it's going to happen. We are going to experience a move of God. But with the trial and the persecution that comes with that move of God, you will not be prepared for that move of God. You will not be prepared for this great and final outpouring of God's Spirit if you don't allow God to do in you what He is desiring, what He has designed to do in and through you. And in order for that to come about, in order for the promise to come about, we're going to have to endure the process. And not just endure it, but we're going to have to believe God for the process. Because going through sanctification, going through the process of being changed, going through the process of being chastised, going through the promise of God showing you what's wrong with your heart and with your... it's not easy.
Come on.
So you're going to have to pray for God to give you patience.
Amen.
You're going to have to pray for God to give you endurance.
Oh, yeah.
You're going to have to pray, God, give me the faith that it takes to believe You, that even when I don't see the promise, I still believe You.
Amen.
And that's why Paul said that faith is the substance of things hoped for. Because even though I can't see it presently right now, even though I can't understand it right now, there's still something on the inside of me that says, Mike, I cannot stop believing God.
Amen.
Even though the devil has beaten me left and right and left me black and blue and left me on the ground for dead, even though I can't move, even though I can barely walk, even though I can barely pick my head up off the pillow because I'm so miserable, I see my sin, I see my wretchedness, I see the flesh, I see all these things, even though all of that is against me, something on the inside of me says, I still believe God. Despite the doubt, despite the confusion, despite the chaos that's going on in my life, I see where I failed God, I see where I didn't believe God, I see where I missed Him, I see where I made a fool of myself, I see all these things, but some kind of way, I don't even understand it. Mm-hmm. I'll be so miserable and wretched and God, what's going on? I don't even understand what's going on. I can barely even believe You. But yet something on the inside of me stirs in me and says, my God, I still believe.
Hallelujah.
I still believe. I want the devil to know I still believe. He tried to kill me, but I still believe.
Hallelujah.
I'm not where I'm supposed to be, but I still believe. I've not achieved that for which I am trying to achieve, but I still believe.
Yes.
I don't see the promises of God like I want to see them, but I still believe.
Yes.
I don't see what I want to see happening and starting and moving in my heart and in my life, but I believe by the grace of God that He's going to do in me what no man can do for me.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
I believe that faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen.
Yes.
My Lord.
Yes.
Evidence means that you have physical proof that whatever happened or is going to happen, you have physical proof that it is going to take place or it has already taken place. That's what evidence is.
Mm.
Evidence is physical proof. So when somebody comes to you and says, well, what is your evidence that God's going to do for you what you say He's going to do? All you have to tell them is, I believe.
Amen.
That's it. That's the evidence.
Yeah.
I don't see it. I don't understand it. All I can see is darkness. It seems like I'm looking down a tunnel and I can't see either which way. I don't understand it. But the evidence that God is going to do something is that my heart is still saying, Ross, you've got to believe God.
Amen.
The Spirit of God on the inside of me is saying, Ross, don't quit.
Yes.
You can't give up.
Lord,
you can't stop now. You can't quit where you are. You see, God can deal with someone who has failed him.
That's right.
God can deal with failure, but he cannot deal with quitters.
Come on. Yes. Come on, brother.
That'll preach right
That's
there.
Good preaching.
Yes.
He can deal with your failure, even
Amen.
As a Christian.
Right. Amen.
Guess what? You're going to fail.
Come on.
Time and time and time. God can deal with that because he's already paid the price
That's
for it.
Right.
But what he cannot deal with is unbelief.
Yes.
He cannot deal with those who refuse to believe him and his redemption plan, because it's through him and his redemption plan that he can work on your behalf.
Amen. That's good.
Hallelujah.
So I don't care how much you failed.
Amen.
I don't care how much you've stumbled. I don't care how much you've fallen down. If something on the inside of you says, I still believe God, I still believe God and his redemption plan, then God has not quit working on you. God will not stop working on you as long as your faith is still placed in Christ and what he's done at the cross.
Yes.
He will not stop. He will not give up on you. He will not quit on you if you won't quit on him.
That's right.
Amen.
Like Brother Swagger says all the time, if you don't quit, God won't quit.
Hallelujah.
I know many of you are believing God for some mighty things. You have some promises in your heart, whether it's lost loved ones or whether it's ministry or whether it's this, that, and the other. I know you're believing God for promises. If you'll just hold on by faith, God will bring those promises to pass.
Hallelujah.
He will. Be encouraged this morning.
Yes.
That God's word will not return void.
That's right.
His word will not, and it does not return void. A lot of times when we begin to experience the promises and the blessings of God, the Lord will allow that for a season. But then he allows the test to come.
Mm-hmm.
Then he allows the trial to come. Then he allows the circumstances to come.
Yes.
And Brother Swagger made a statement that I want to read. I want to quote Brother Swagger. He said this, "With every promise of God, it seems as if the Lord allows Satan a certain amount of latitude to hinder that promise. Of course, Satan desires that we give up altogether, while God allows the activity of the evil one for an entirely different purpose. As we've stated many times, faith must be tested, and great faith must be tested greatly. Will we continue to believe God despite circumstances, despite problems, despite difficulties? Or when facing these things, will we fold under the pressure and quit? As stated, getting from the promise to the possession is never uneventful." When God begins to bless us and he begins to move in our hearts and in our lives, the process then begins.
Mm-hmm.
He saves us. He does miraculous things in our hearts and in our lives. He begins to bless us. He begins to pour in us his promises. But then here comes sanctification.
Yeah.
And it's no coincidence, I believe, that the longest part of the process, because when God promises you something, it's instantaneous. When he speaks something to your heart, when he shows something to you that he has in store for you, that he has in store for your life, whether it be out of this word or whether it be a personal promise that he's given to you that lines up with this word,
Amen.
Either which one, when God does that, Satan then comes to begin to hinder that promise. He then comes. There's a joy, there's an excitement there at the beginning.
Yes.
But then we see the trials, we see the things that we have to face in order for those things to come about. And it's no coincidence that the promise is instantaneous, the possession is instantaneous, because when God finally decides to say, okay, here's your promise, it's instantaneous. He makes up his mind and bam, here it
yes.
is. But the process is so long.
Yes.
Because more important to God, not only should it be more important to you, but more important to God is that your heart is for him. That you be in relationship with him. That you know who your God is.
Amen.
You see, the blessings and the promises, they show us and they prove to us who God is. But the time of trial and chastisement, during those times, we begin to learn who we really are.
Amen.
And we cannot truly know who God is. We cannot truly know the God that we serve if first we do not know what's wrong with ourselves.
Amen.
That's why Romans 7 had to precede and come before Romans 8.
That's it.
Because before Paul could receive the abundance of revelation, before Paul could experience the victory that God so desired for him to experience through the great message of the cross, Paul had to be brought to a wretched man experience.
Right, right.
He had to be brought to the end of himself. He had to be brought to the realization that I, in and of myself, cannot do what God needs to be done. God has promises, but I cannot fulfill them.
Yeah.
God wants me to live holy and righteously, but I cannot do that in and of my own power. God wants me to speak for Him. God wants me to do this. God wants this person saved, that person saved, so on and so forth. You fill in the blank. But all of those things that we so desire, we cannot accomplish them in and of our own power. We've got to be brought to the ends of our, to the end of ourselves.
Right.
The chastening of the Lord. And that's what we're going to talk about in Hebrews 12. The chastening of the Lord. The correction of the Lord. The rebuke of the Lord. The chastening of the Lord. It causes us to depend greater upon the faith that God has already given us.
Right,
right. Because it's not that I need a different faith for the promise than what I need to go through the chastisement. The same faith that's going to bring me through the chastisement, the correction, the trial and the circumstance, the same faith that's going to bring me through that is the same faith that is going to obtain the promise that God has given to my heart. And that promise could be that sin shall not have dominion over you.
Amen.
That's the greatest promise there is. Is that I can learn how to walk righteously. I can learn how to walk victoriously before my God, with my God, in my God, from my God. I can learn how to walk with Him. I can learn how to talk with Him. Like the old hymn says, He walks with me and He talks with me and He tells me that I'm His own.
Yes.
And the joy that we share as we tarry there, none other is found but in Christ alone.
Hallelujah.
See, that's the most important thing in this walk with the Lord, is that you know who your God is.
Amen.
But before you can know who He is, you've got to realize who you are.
That's right.
We've got to realize that I don't have it within myself to do what God is desiring me to do, to believe what God is desiring me to believe. It's not that we need more faith, like I said. It's that our faith needs to be purified.
Yes,
it's that we've got to learn how to rely more and more upon the faith that God has already given us. Because I know what it is to go through trial. I know what it is to go through discouragement. I know what it is to go and be downtrodden and for your soul, like David said, for your soul to be vexed. For you don't know which way to go. I'm talking about being a Christian.
Yes.
I'm not talking about a sinner being unsaved. I'm talking about being a Christian.
Right.
You know the mess. You know the truth of the gospel. But yet trials come, circumstances come, and they're not always outward circumstances that we can see on the outward. Sometimes nobody else knows what we're going through. But the inside, our heart is fighting and it is warring just to believe God another day. Paul said it like this, that the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit lusts against the flesh, and it's a constant warring. There's a constant enmity. There's a constant fight going on the inside of us. Because we have not yet learned how to submit to faith and grace. We have not yet learned how to submit to the Spirit of God in everything that we do. And we're not going to learn how to do it 100% perfectly until we go home to be with the Lord. That's just a matter of the fact.
Thank you, Jesus.
So I'm not calling upon us to be perfect. That's not because, my God, if anybody knows, I'm the most imperfect thing that ever's walked this earth. Don't ask my wife about it because she's probably got a lot of reasons to tell you. But that's the truth. The most imperfect. So I'm not calling upon us to be perfect, but I am calling upon us to pursue perfection.
Amen.
To pursue the righteousness of God that is in Christ Jesus. I'm not calling upon us to pursue our own righteousness, to try to make our own selves righteous, to try to do for ourselves what we know. I'm calling upon us to pursue after the righteousness of God.
Amen.
That's the reason for the trial. That's the reason for the chastisement. The reason for the trial and the circumstances is so that your eyes will not be so focused on these great promises and blessings of God, but that your eyes would be focused more on the blesser than on the blessing.
Hallelujah.
That you would pursue the blesser who has called you more than the blessing that you're searching and seeking for.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
That's the most important thing. That is the most important thing. More than obtaining a natural promise, true faith. Listen to this. So many times we think of faith, like I've been saying it this whole message. We think of faith in the aspect of having to believe God for certain things, for certain outward things, natural things to happen or take place in our life. But true faith will cause you not only to believe God for those mighty promises and blessings, but true faith will cause you to pursue after the righteousness of God.
Yes.
To be manifest in your heart and in your life.
Amen.
Because when you said yes to Jesus, you were placed into a position of righteousness.
Amen.
God now looks at you as righteous. God now looks at you as saved because your sins have been cast as far as the east is from the west. That's your position with God. Positionally, you are perfect with God, but conditionally, where we are at this present moment and in this present time, we're not walking as we ought to walk. We're not doing as we ought to do. We're not saying as we ought to say. And God wants to take our condition and bring it to our position. He wants to make our condition look more and more like our position each and every day that we live. So He allows the chastisement to come, to correct us, to show us where we've gone wrong, to show us where we've not believed Him.
Yes.
And more than anything, He's trying to show us our doubt. He's trying to show us our unbelief. He's trying to show us where we're depending upon the flesh rather than depending upon His Spirit.
That's
where
right.
We're depending upon ourselves rather than depending upon Him and His redemption plan.
Amen.
So the question is today, what is it that you're believing God for? Because true faith says, I'm not believing God just for outward and natural circumstances to take place in my life, but I'm believing God. True faith says that I have to believe God for His righteousness and His life to be made manifest in my mortal body. Paul would say it in Galatians 5:5, that we through the Spirit do wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. So you and I have to learn how through the Spirit, by faith, to wait for the righteousness of God to continually be made manifest in your mortal mind and in your mortal body. And Paul would say this about chastisement. Go back to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 5. Listen what Paul says. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as children. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of Him. Some of you are wondering, why am I going through this? Why am I facing this trial? Why am I facing this circumstance? You see, it's not always the devil that's doing to you what's going on in your life. Many times, the Lord allows things to take place in your life to show you what He wants to show you. And listen, this is what Paul doesn't talk about Satan in this passage of Scripture. He never one time mentions the devil in Hebrews chapter 12.
Come on.
He doesn't mention Satan as the reason for trial.
That's good.
He doesn't mention Satan as the reason for chastisement and correction and rebuke. He says, no, the Lord brings chastisement. The Lord brings rebuke. Listen to what he says. For whom the Lord loves, He chastens and scourges every son whom He receives. So listen to this. When you face a trial, when you face a circumstance, more importantly than anything else, God is trying to show you something.
Yes.
If God didn't love you, you wouldn't be facing trial. You wouldn't be facing circumstances. Things wouldn't be going wrong in your life if God didn't love you. But He loves you enough to allow these things to come up in your life, to allow the struggles, to allow the doubts, to allow the fears. He allows these things to come up to show you, because He loves you, to show you that you're not yet where you need to be.
Mm.
Verse 7, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. For what is a son? What son is he whom the Father chastens not? But if you be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are you bastards and not sons. So you're fatherless. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh, which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily, earthly fathers, for a few days chastened us after their own pleasure. But he, God, for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness.
Hallelujah.
I got this from Mike Thomas. He ministered for you guys just a couple weeks ago. But if you remember in Jesus' earthly ministry, at the beginning of his ministry, one of the first things that Jesus did in the Gospels, you can read this in the Gospels, one of the first things that Jesus did was he went into the temple and he cleansed the temple.
That's right.
The Bible says that he sat down, doesn't it say it, Mike? That Jesus sat down and he made a whip. He made a cord. The Bible takes enough time to tell us that Jesus sat down and he fashioned a whip for the temple. Everything that Jesus did in his earthly ministry physically was to show us what he would want and desire to do in and through us spiritually.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's why he started his ministry by turning the water into wine. To show us that no matter what's going on in your life, I can take what's wrong and I can make it right.
Hallelujah. Amen.
That's why he healed the lepers of their disease. Leprosy being a type of sin. Showing us that God's greatest desire is to heal us from sin. That's why he opened the blinded eyes, to show us that with lost and without God, our eyes are darkened.
Amen.
Our eyes have not been illuminated. Our eyes cannot see what God wants us to see. But when he saves us, when we're born again, when we're filled with his spirit, all of a sudden, we see things differently
Amen.
Than what we've seen them before. Things don't look the same way they used to look. We don't act the same way we used to
Amen.
Act. So everything Jesus did in his earthly ministry was to show us what he would do for us spiritually after he gave his life on Calvary's cross.
Right, right, Jesus.
So the Bible says that Jesus sat down and he fashioned a whip. He took time. He didn't just go and grab any whip. But he took time himself to sit down and make his own whip. So that he could go into the temple. And a lot of times, you know, we read that passage. And honestly, I'd never seen it this way before until Mike preached it. But a lot of times we look at that passage, you know, and we relate it to, you know, kicking false doctrine out the church. And that's true. Because false doctrine has no place in the church no matter which way you look at it. So we look at it in that sense a lot of times. But man, when I heard Mike say it this time when he was preaching, I never heard it before.
Come on.
But my God, it rolled all over me when he said it.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's a type of sanctification.
That's right.
That is a type of what God, the work that God begins in us and through us after he saves us, after he fills us with his spirit, and after he pours his blessings and his promises out upon us. That God loves you enough that he has a certain trial.
Mm-hmm.
He has a certain circumstance awaiting you to root out of you what's in you.
Come on.
Might not even know what it is. But let me tell you something. You might not even be knowledgeable of it. You might not even see it this morning. You might have never thought that there was this going on the inside of you, that there was this that was wrong with you. But God has picked out for you, fashioned for you individually a whip so that he can come by his spirit into your temple and begin to tear up and tear down everything that is not of himself. That's the process of sanctification. That's the process of how we begin to learn who God is. Because like I said, the modern church will tell you to live by faith for all these things. But God is telling us to live by faith to believe him for the chastisement, that we would say, God, show me where I've gone wrong.
Yes.
God, show me where my mind is thinking not the right way. Show me where my heart is bent in a wrong direction. Show me where my faith needs to be purified, where my faith needs to be edified. God, show me the inner recesses of my heart that I cannot see, so that I can see and I can realize how good of a God that you truly are.
Hallelujah.
Because you cannot realize how good your God is.
Amen.
Until you realize how bad off you truly are.
Amen. Amen.
And I'm not saying we're not saved. That's not what I'm saying up here. If you're struggling, if you're fighting to believe God, I'm here to encourage you this morning. That the same faith he gave the Old Testament prophets to believe him for the promises and the blessings that were to come, he's given you that same faith this morning to believe him to endure the process that he has you in.
Hallelujah.
I don't know why you are where you are. I don't know what's going on in your heart and in your life. Half the time, I don't even know where I am, honestly.
Amen.
I mean, just to be honest with you. But you know what? I believe God.
Yes.
Amen. I don't understand why God allows certain things to happen. I don't understand it all. But he says that he chastens us in verse 10 for our profit.
Mm.
It's profitable unto us that God, through the power of the Holy Ghost, comes in us and addresses in us what is not right about us. Because there's no greater problem that you will ever face than the problem of self.
Yes.
The problem of flesh.
That's right.
Because it's self that fights against the Spirit of God. It's self that wars against the plan of God. Because like I said at the beginning, there's something on the inside of us. For the fallen nature causes us to think and believe that there's something we can do in order to earn from God what he's freely given unto us. So the chastening process, and listen to this. This is one of my favorite verses in the entirety of the Word of God. Hebrews 12 and verse 11. The Lord brought this passage of Scripture to me several years ago in Bible college. Now, no chastening for the present time seemeth to be joyous, but grievous.
Mm.
The chastening, the process of sanctification is grievous.
Come on.
Mm-hmm.
Because God is trying to show you that you can't do it.
That's it.
More than anything, that's what he's trying to show you. That's the place he's trying to bring you to. All these things, you cannot do it in and of your own power. But listen to this. No chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, listen to what Paul says. Lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight the paths for your feet. Lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed.
Mm.
Follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. So first he tells us that chastening, it is going to be grievous.
Yeah.
But then he says, don't be discouraged. Mm. Believe God for this reason.
Right.
Believe God because somewhere on the inside of you, you know that after you come out of this thing, you're going to know more about God than you've ever known before. Let me tell you something. The trial and the circumstance, and I know what I'm talking about, makes you attentive to the voice of God.
Yes.
Because in the trial and the circumstance, you realize you don't have what it takes.
Wow.
And you realize, Matt, that you need some help.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Me and Matt were texting the other day, and I think it was actually Friday. I hadn't heard from Matt since he asked me to preach. So I texted him. I said, hey, man, we still on for Sunday? And he said, oh, yeah, man, we're still on. I'm hoping you're going to be there Sunday morning. I said, yeah, man, I'll be there. He said, man, forgive me. He said, I guess I'm not a pastor like I'm supposed to be. He said, I guess I should have got back with you and checked up on you. I said, yeah. I said, well, I guess you're kind of an unorthodox pastor. And he said, yeah, man, whatever. He said, yeah, man, I need some help. And he said, thank God that, you know, we're not orthodox. Thank God we don't have it all together.
Amen. Amen.
Because if we had it all together, we wouldn't realize how much we need Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
If we had it all together, we wouldn't realize how much, if everything went perfect 100% of the time, we wouldn't realize our need for the Savior.
Amen.
And you see, that's what the chastening is doing in your life, or that's what it should be doing. The faith of the Son of God should cause you to address yourself.
That's right.
It should cause you to address yourself to say, I'm not where I need to be, and I need the help of God. I need the power of God. I need the presence of God moving and operating in my heart and in my life. There should be a constant, and I'm not talking about a focus on self, but every day there should be a constant addressal of self. What do I mean by that? Luke 9:23. Jesus said, if any man will come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow after me. And what did he say? He said we had to do this daily.
Yes.
That we must daily realize, deny ourselves, realize I don't have what it takes in and of my own power.
Amen.
I don't have the ability to live for God as I want to. I don't have the ability to do for Him what I want to do.
Amen.
I don't have the ability, but I take up Christ. I take up what He's done for me at Calvary's cross. And I pursue, I follow after the mark, the prize of the high calling of God that is in Christ Jesus. That's why Paul said at the beginning of this chapter, chapter 12, he said, let us lay aside every weight and every sin that does so easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us.
Yes.
Why are we going to need patience? Because what God needs to do in you is not going to happen overnight.
Amen. That's
I hate to tell you, but it's not going to happen overnight. You're not going to be changed overnight. You're not going to go to bed tonight and wake up and, man, everything's just perfectly all right.
That's right.
You know, that's a facade. That's only a dream.
Amen.
And the reason it's not that way is because we're so jacked up.
Come on.
I mean, that's the simple fact of the matter. We are, like John says all the time, my buddy John Collier, he says it all the time, man, I am all jacked up.
Yeah.
And you better believe it.
We need some help.
We need some help up in here.
Yeah.
We've got to have the continual help, the continual
Amen.
Aid of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Lord.
So what I wanted to encourage you this morning with is true faith. If you truly believe in Christ and what He's done for you at the cross, that faith is not only going to believe God for His great blessings, His great promises, His great outpourings of His Spirit, but that faith is also going to address your own heart.
Right.
Going to address yourself in saying that, God, you know what? Everyone around me is not the issue. I'm the issue.
Amen.
And Lord, it's me that you've got to fix.
Yes.
God told Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 18, and I'm closing in just a minute. In Jeremiah chapter 18, he told Jeremiah, go down to the potter's house.
Oh, yes.
And there will I cause you to hear my word.
Mm.
You know what goes on at the potter's house?
Mm.
That potter sits there in his chair, and he places the clay upon the wheel, and he begins to turn that wheel, and he begins to mold that clay, and he throws water onto the clay and molds it and molds it. And after a little while, he looks at it and he sees an imperfection in it. He sees a rock in it. He sees a piece of dirt that's too hard to be molded. So you know what he has to do? He has to rip that thing off of the wheel, remove the rock, place it back on the wheel, and start over again. He has to mold it, mold it, mold it. And then he sees another imperfection. And then he has to pull it out. Another, pull it out. Until it's perfectly how he wants it to be. You see, that's what God is desiring to do in and through us. Is that we stay on the potter's wheel. Even when he has to pluck those things out of us that don't feel good. Even when he has to show us areas of our lives that are not lining up to his word. Even when it hurts to face the reality that, God, there's some things in me that are not right. There's some feelings, there's some thoughts, there's some emotions, there's some actions that are not right, Lord. But He cares enough about you not to just throw you to the side, but keep you on the wheel.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
He cares enough about you to take the little imperfections out of you one by one. When you're done, like Brother Larson says, when you're done with your current issue, God's going to take up the next one.
Hallelujah.
See, that's the good news of the gospel.
Thank you, Jesus.
You see, we, in a fleshly sense, in a fleshly mind, we look at the process and we stray away from it. We scare away from it because it's not easy.
Right.
It's not fun. It's not always fun. It's not always easy. But if we realize that God is trying to work a work in us, specially formed, specially made by His hand, then we'll have the faith. Then we'll have what it takes to endure. And that's why Paul said that we have to have patience.
Yes.
We have to abide under the hand of God.
Yes.
That's what patience means. To get under that thing, to abide under it, and allow God to do for us what He wants to do.
Amen.
A couple of years ago, and I'm closing, so singers, musicians, whatever you want to come up. A couple of years ago, I was in prayer meeting in Bible college. And it was either a Tuesday or a Thursday. I can't remember which day, but I was in prayer meeting and I was just crying out to the Lord. And
Thank you, Jesus.
And this was at a time in my life when I had a hunger for God like I've never had before. I had a desperation for the Spirit of God. And I remember I would be on my floor and I would just weep. I would weep and just say, God, I want to know You.
Yeah.
God, teach me Your voice. Show me Your ways. God, do in me what only You. And I remember I would just cry out to God, God, I want to know Your voice. I want to know Your voice. And I remember one day in prayer meeting, I was sitting in the corner of the room on the floor. And I was just praying, seeking the face of God. And I said, Lord, teach me Your voice. That's what I would pray all the time. And that's what we should pray. We should pray that every day of our lives. God, teach me Your voice. Cause me to be sensitive to Your Spirit. It's so imperative that we know the voice of God.
Amen.
And He spoke to me. He said, while learning My voice, Ross, I remember it like it's yesterday. He said, while learning My voice, you must as well learn what My voice is not. And in order for us to learn what His voice is not, He's going to have to bring us through some things. We're going to have to miss it a few times in order for us to finally learn what God's trying to teach us. Maybe some of you are sitting here and saying, man, I have missed it a few times. I've missed it more than just a few times. But guess what? God's trying to teach you something. And in the end, the chastisement, the correction, the rebuke, the reproof, it's all going to be worth it because like the Bible says in Hebrews 12 and 11, it's not joyous at the moment, but afterward, it's going to yield in you what God is desiring to yield in you.
Yeah.
It's going to produce in you that which God is desiring for it to produce. Let's stand to our feet this morning.
Yes.
It's going to produce in you what God is desiring for it to produce.
Hallelujah.
So faith is not just believing God for the promises and the blessings, but faith is also saying, God, whatever it takes, whatever You've got to do to teach me, Lord, let it come.
Yes.
Lord, I know it's going to hurt. I know it's not going to be fun, but Lord, I also know there's things in my heart that need to be changed. There's areas of my life that need to be transformed. There's things in my mind that need to be transformed. So Lord, do it. Bring the chastisement. Lord, show me the correction. Correct me where I've gone wrong. Show me where I've doubted You. Show me where I've gone astray. So that, Lord, Your righteousness, the peaceable fruit of righteousness, can be manifest in my heart and in my life.